welcome to the Christmas edition of the Telusk Forum.
We're in festive mood and we're keen to share with you a cornucopia of local talent.
In the programme today, Helen reads two seasonal poems.
Vaughan entertains us with some little known and spurious music by the master J.S. Bach.
Dr. Carl brings us an Advent message.
Melanie reads a thought-provoking reflection on the birth of Jesus.
Helen from Crick Howlers wishes us a happy Christmas in her own inimitable way.
And Morgan tells us a very poignant Christmas story from an unlikely perspective.
Then the Large family bring us a lovely Christmas worship song.
Finally, Anthony reads from A Child's Christmas in Wales by Dylan Thomas.
We wish you all a happy Christmas and a joyful new year.
Hello. First of all, I'd like to say thank you so much to everyone who contributed to the sale of the calendars. I think I've raised nearly £400 for Papyrus and Beat, so many thanks for those kind contributions. The first poem I'd like to read this time isn't one by me, it's by the well-known person Anonymous, written in the 10th century, and it's a wonderful evocation of winter and the cold snow. And it's very sparse and wonderful language, so I shall read you most of it. Winter. Wind, sharp, hillside bleak, hard to win shelter. Ford is impassable, lake is frozen. A man may near stand on one stalk of grass. Cold bed of fish in the gloom of ice, stag lean, bearded reeds, evening brief, slant of bent wood, snow falls, hoarfrost white, idle shield on an old shoulder, a monstrous wind freezes the grass, snow falls, high on the ice, sweeps the wind atop the thick trees, a stout shield that on a bold shoulder, snow falls, covers the veil, warriors hurry to battle, I'll not go. Wound does not let me. So thank you for listening to that one. I'd like to follow it up then with a poem for Christmas itself called Christ Child that I wrote a few years ago. Christ Child, slowly, heavily making their way, bearing the child to be born in the hay, on the floor with the beasts, no comfort to spare. His body so small, his mother with care wraps him tightly around, asleep, beatific, and nowhere a crown. The hope for this world, his immaculate birth, we bow now before him, our Saviour on earth. Thank you, happy Christmas to everyone.
Thank you. Christmas 2020 is going to be very different. It's certainly not going to be celebrated in the way we all usually do, and in the way we come to expect. And realizing this, I thought this year that I would do some Advent reflections, think about the meaning of Christmas and what it really is, and not the things I've added to it over the years. I don't know about you, but I find the Bible to be a book capable of surprising. Very often I read familiar passages, but new light shines on them, even though they're old stories. And so it was this year. I was reading in the book of John and came across some words which Jesus spoke to one of his early followers, Nathanael. You can find them in John chapter 1 and verse 51. Jesus said, "Most assuredly, I say to you, hereafter you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." When Nathanael heard those words, he would have recognized the story immediately. Jesus is referring to Jacob's ladder, the story we find in the book of Genesis about the dream which Jacob had when he was running away from Esau. But Jesus changes the story. He takes the ladder away and he says, now the angels are going up and down on this character called the Son of Man. And all the gospel writers agree that the favourite name that Jesus had for himself was the Son of Man. So right here at the beginning of John's gospel, Jesus is saying, I am the way from earth to heaven. And later on, he'll actually use those words in John chapter 14. He says, I am the way, the truth and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. The new connection for me this year, though, was to think about Advent in the light of this picture of the ladder. When we think of a ladder, we think of a number of things, but one of the most important issues is, will it reach where I need it to go? Will it be big enough to get where I need it to go? And Jesus says that this particular ladder will reach all the way from earth to heaven. And we all need a ladder like that. We all need to have confidence in a ladder like that. Now, can this ladder be trusted? Has it been tried and tested? Well, John, the apostle who wrote the Gospel of John, he says, yes, yes it can. Right at the beginning of his gospel, he says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So John says, one Son of Man has come down from heaven and been made flesh, just like us. And so he's tried that ladder out, and it can be relied upon. And Paul says similar thing in Philippians. In Philippians chapter 2, Paul says this, Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself of no reputation, took the form of a servant, and came in the likeness of men. So in that picture, Paul says, you can see Jesus at the top of this ladder, but he's not holding on to the rungs and refusing to budge. Rather, he's willingly emptying himself, taking on the form of a servant, and coming in the likeness of men. But the bottom of the ladder is not Bethlehem. It's not the dirty stable or the weak body of a baby. That would be a huge ladder, wouldn't it? But Jesus has further to go. He has to humble himself even more. Paul goes on, he says, he came in the likeness of men, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. See how far he came? Bethlehem isn't the bottom of the ladder. Calvary is. In fact, the Bible says that Jesus came not to be born, but to die and to be placed in a grave for us, for our sakes. So Easter is the bottom of the ladder rather than Christmas. And of course, at Easter, The whole thing turns around again and Jesus rises from the dead. He ascends into heaven and now is seated at the right hand of the Father. So the ladder's been tested both in the coming down and the going up, and it can bear our weight. The Son of Man is the ladder to God, the way to God, and it's strong enough to hold all who trust themselves in him. He came down to earth from heaven, who is God and Lord of all.
Sometimes I wonder if Mary breastfed Jesus, if she cried out when he bit her, or if she sobbed when he would not latch. And sometimes I wonder if this is all too vulgar to ask in a church full of men without milk stains on their shirts or coconut oil on their breasts, preaching from pulpits off limits to the Mother of God. But then I think of feeding Jesus, birthing Jesus, the expulsion of blood and smell of sweat, the salt of a mother's tears onto the soft head of the salt of the earth. Feeling lonely and tired, hungry, annoyed, overwhelmed, loving. And I think if the vulgarity of birth is not honestly preached by men who carry power but not burden, who carry privilege but not labour, who carry authority but not submission, then it should not be preached at all, because the real scandal of the birth of God lies in the cracked nipples of a 14-year-old and not in the sermons of ministers who say women are too delicate to lead.
King John was not a good man. All the cards upon his shelf that wished him lots of Christmas cheer and fortune in the coming year were never from his near and dear, but only from himself. We wish you all good friends here a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. A very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. King John was not a good man. All the cards was not a good man. All the cards upon his Christmas.
Christmas cheer and fortune in the coming year. As we approach Christmas, we are full of expectation and anticipation. But for many people, Christmas is a time of anxiety, breakdown, largely because it's become so commercialised and so consumer-orientated. And when this happens, Christ goes out of Christmas. That's not the way he would have wanted it. I'm going to read you a story which I hope brings out the real meaning of Christmas. A story of reconciliation, compassion, love, and reaching out to the poor. And I've called it The Outcast. It was bitterly cold in Bethlehem. Snowflakes were starting to fall. It was a market day, and many extra people had arrived because of an order given by the Roman governor. Nida was very cold and extremely hungry. He was only 8 years old, but he was an outcast, which means that he had no home, nobody fed nor clothed him, and nobody loved him. His parents had died in an earthquake, leaving him without any relatives, and no one was prepared to take him in. He survived by sleeping rough, stealing and scavenging, picking up scraps thrown out by other people, and everyone in Bethlehem knew him. And when they saw him, they drove him away, shouting, "Be off, you little outcast." He never cried. He never begged. He just struggled to keep alive. On this particular day, he found nothing to eat. He tried to steal some food from the saddlebag of a traveller's mule tied up outside the inn. But the innkeeper spied him and chased him away, shouting, "Be off, you little thief, be off!" He escaped down an alley. But when he sneaked out again, he was spotted by some teenagers who threw stones at him and shouted, "Be off, little outcast, be off!" Because he was always running away, he seldom spoke to other children. But animals were different. They knew and loved him. He slept with dogs, huddled together in dark corners for warmth. Sometimes they even brought him food. As it got dark that evening, Nida got colder and colder and hungrier and hungrier. There was only one other place to find food. It was dangerous, but it was worth a try. He set out for the sheepfolds on the hillside above the town. He had to pass the inn, but there was a commotion going on because there were too many people and too few rooms, so no one noticed him slip by in the shadows. A little further on, he met a collie dog coming in the opposite direction. He buried his face in its soft, warm fur. It nuzzled him in return and said, "This will be a night to remember. What a night. God go with you, little brother." Then it hurried on its way. "Strange," said Nidic to himself. Once out of the town, he crept up the hill in the shadow of a stone wall. He met an old dog fox trotting silently towards him. "What an amazing night," said the fox as it passed. "What a night to remember. God go with you, little brother." And it trotted on down the hill. "Strange," thought Nida. "Very strange." But he shook his head and carried on his way. A moment later, a whole family of field mice hurried past in the grass, chattering as they went. "What a night, what a night, what a night to remember, what a night." "Stranger, stranger and stranger," said Nida to himself. He reached the first sheepfold. It was like a very small field, fenced round with rough stone and prickly thorn bush hedge on the top. Here, the shepherds brought their sheep for safety at night. Peeping through a gap in the thorns, he could see the shepherds. There were four of them, keeping watch round a blazing fire. Except for a small space round the fire, there were sheep everywhere. Nigerich could see their leather haversacks, and these, he knew, contained their food and drink for the night. He found a place where he could just squeeze through the hedge without getting too badly scratched. Soon he was among the sheep, crawling silently on his tummy among their feet, and he made his way toward the shepherd's haversack. Looking down, the sheep recognized him at once. They neither moved nor made a sound. The shepherds went on warming themselves and chatting round the fire. It took a long time, but at last he got there. Lying underneath a particularly woolly sheep, he very slowly and very cautiously stretched out his arm until he could touch the leather bag. Then, even more slowly and silently, he undid its buckle and eased a bundle, which he knew contained food, out of the bag and across the grass towards him under the sheep. Then he wriggled away backwards until he judged he was at a safe distance. He unwrapped the bundle and began to eat. Suddenly, the silence was shattered by a scream of rage. Squinting between two sheep, Nidick could see in the firelight a furious shepherd holding up the empty sack. "It's that thieving little outcast," he shouted. "He can't be far away. I'll find him. I'll kill him." He shrieked. Nidder, shrinking back among the sheep, knew that he meant it. With that, the man began pushing through the sheep, throwing them aside, searching, searching. He was heading straight for where Nidder lay among the remains of the food, now trampled by the stampeding sheep. The shepherd saw him, made a grab for him. He knew he was going to be killed. All at once, the sky was filled with the brightest light you could possibly imagine. The man stopped in his tracks. Then he spun round, looking upwards. In that instant, Nidder was away and over the wall, running as fast as he could. At last, safe in the shadows of a distant thorn bush, he stopped. He had to look. The sky was brighter than he had ever known it at midday. It seemed to flash and sparkle with pale blue and golden rays, and amongst these amazing shafts of light, the sky seemed to be filled with the shapes of shining people. But even more amazing was the sound. There was music and singing such as he had never dreamed of. For the first time in his little life, Nidder understood what beauty meant. His poor little heart felt as if it would melt. And then he heard those words, clear as crystal, speaking as if directly to him. And yet, at the same time, to the whole world. Words from out of the depth of the music. Good news. Good news. A babe is born in Bethlehem. He has come to save you. Go and find him. He will bring you peace on earth. Give glory to God. Go, little Nidder. Go and find him. Nidder didn't wait to hear more. He set off down the hill for the town, running, running. Now he understood what the animals were talking about. When he reached the outskirts of Bethlehem, he slowed down and moved cautiously down the alley that led to the inn. But although there was no moon, the stars seemed much brighter than usual, and one particularly bright star seemed to shine directly over the inn. As he crept past the inn door, it opened. and the bright light showed three very well-dressed, foreign-looking people talking together. Nidda dashed for the cover of the stable door nearby and nipped inside. As he would have expected, there were several mules munching hay in their stalls, but somehow there was something unusual about the place. A strange feeling seemed to fill the air. It seemed to take hold of him. For the first time in his life, he didn't feel the need to be looking out for danger. Then he noticed that there was a soft, warm glow at the far end of the stable. He peered towards it. There were people there. As he crept closer, he could see a man and a woman were bending over a manger. Then the woman lifted something out, something that seemed to be bathed in a warm, bright light. And to his surprise, Nidhogg realised that it was a baby. But he knew that this was no ordinary baby. He moved slowly towards them. As he did so, he realised that there were animals watching in silence from every dark corner. He knelt down between his friends, the collie dog and the old dog fox, and watched. There was a noise behind him. The door opened, and the light of a lantern shone across the threshold. And to his amazement, he saw the shepherds come in. To his surprise, he felt no fear. Fear didn't seem possible in here. The shepherds went up to the manger and spoke to the man and the woman. They looked at the baby. Then they did a very unexpected thing. They knelt on the floor and they worshipped the baby. Almost immediately, the door opened again and the three well-dressed foreigners came in. And they too approached the manger. They seemed to give presents to the baby, and then they too knelt among the straw and the dirt and worshipped the baby. For the first time in his poor little life, Nidhogg understood the meaning of both peace and love. The whole stable was filled with peace and love. And he knew that somehow this came from the baby. After what seemed a very long time, the shepherds got up to leave. And Nidhogg, for some reason he could never afterwards explain, felt that he just had to leave the stable first. He slipped out and he hid in a doorway up the alley leading to the hillside and the sheepfolds. After a while, he heard them coming, the light of the lantern swinging ahead of them. They were talking excitedly. He recognised the voice of the one whose food he had stolen and who had tried to kill him. "What a night to remember," the man was saying. "What an amazing night." "Nothing will ever be the same again," said another shepherd. "You may think I'm mad," said the first man, "but I'm going to find that Nidhogg if it kills me. And I'm going to..." And his voice seemed to choke somewhat. "I'm going to," he said, "I'm going to take him in. I'm going to give him a home. I'm going to At that moment, the light from the lantern swung full onto the doorway where Nidhogg was hiding. Before he knew what was happening, Nidhogg found himself in the arms of that big, burly shepherd. And for the first time in his life, the little boy burst into tears of happiness. Thank you.
stepped down from heaven. Humbly you came, God of all creation, here with us in a starlit manger. Wise men bring their treasures, shepherds below. Angel voices sing of peace on earth. What have I to
From A Child's Christmas in Wales by Dylan Thomas. One Christmas was so much like another. In those years around the sea town corner, now and out of all sound except the distant speaking of the voices I sometimes hear a moment before sleep, that I can never remember whether it snowed for 6 days and six nights when I was 12, or whether it snowed for 12 days and 12 nights when I was 6. It was on the afternoon of the day of Christmas Eve, and I was in Mrs. Prothero's garden, waiting for cats with her son Jim. It was snowing. It was always snowing at Christmas. December, in my memory, is white as Lapland, though there were no reindeers. But there were cats. Patient, cold and callous, our hands wrapped in socks, we waited to snowball the cats. Sleek and as long as jaguars and horrible whiskered, spitting and snarling, they would slide and sidle over the white back garden walls, and the lynx-eyed hunters, Jim and I, fur-capped and moccasined trappers from Hudson Bay off Mumbles Road, would hurl our deadly snowballs at the green of their eyes. The wise cats never appeared. We were so still, Eskimo-footed Arctic marksmen in the muffling silence of the eternal snows, eternal ever since Wednesday, that we never heard Mrs. Prothero's first cry from her igloo at the bottom of the garden. Or, if we heard it at all, it was to us like the far-off challenge of our enemy and prey, the neighbour's polar cat. But soon the voice grew louder. "Fire!" cried Mrs. Prothero, and she beat the dinner gong. And we ran down the garden with the snowballs in our arms towards the house, and smoke indeed was pouring out of the dining room, and the gong was bombulating, and Mrs. Prothero was announcing ruin like a town crier in Pompeii. This was better than all the cats in Wales standing on the wall in a row. We bounded into the house laden with snowballs and stopped at the open door of the smoke-filled room. Something was burning all right. Perhaps it was Mr. Prothero, who always slept there after dinner with a newspaper over his face. But he was standing in the middle of the room, saying, "A fine Christmas!" and smacking at the smoke with a slipper. "Call the fire brigade," cried Mrs. Prothero, as she beat the gong. "They won't be there," said Mr. Prothero. "It's Christmas." There was no fire to be seen, only clouds of smoke and Mr. Prothero standing in the middle of them, waving his slipper as though he were conducting. "Do something," he said, and we threw all our snowballs into the smoke. I think we missed Mr. Prothero and ran out of the house to the telephone box. "Let's call the police as well," Jim said, "and the ambulance, and Ernie Jenkins, he likes fires." But we only called the fire brigade. And soon the fire engine came, and three tall men in helmets brought a hose into the house, and Mr. Prothero got out just in time before they turned it on. Nobody could have had a noisier Christmas Eve. And when the firemen turned off the hose and were standing in the wet, smoky room, Jim's aunt, Miss Prothero, came downstairs and peered in at them. Jim and I waited, very quietly, to hear what she would say to them. She said the right thing, always. She looked at the tall firemen in their shining helmets, standing among the smoke and cinders and dissolving snowballs, and she said, "Would you like anything to read?" Thank you.